somewhat familiar with your Bible, or if you're somewhat familiar with Easter, you understand that the prophecies of the Old Testament were fulfilled in Christ, that Jesus would come and he'd have victory over the enemy, that Jesus would be born of a virgin, that Jesus would be the seed of David, that Jesus would be a miracle worker, that Jesus would ride into Jerusalem on a donkey, that Jesus would be tried and executed, that he would be buried in a borrowed tomb, that Jesus would not stay in the grave, but that indeed he would rise again. And I want to remind you today that the culmination of all that we believe is found very clearly in what Jesus said about himself. In Luke chapter 18, the Bible tells us that he took the 12 that he had, and when he looked at them, he said, "We're going to Jerusalem that all things might be fulfilled that are written in the prophets concerning me." He reminded them that he would indeed be delivered to the Gentiles, mocked and despitefully entreated and spit upon, and they would scourge him, put him to death, but the third day he would rise again. If Jesus said that about himself, if Jesus' own words about himself was that he would be crucified and rise again, and it happened exactly as he said it, we can believe it. And I would encourage you today to believe every word that Jesus said, that he himself prophesied that he would be crucified, that he himself prophesied that he would die a literal death, and he himself prophesied that he would rise again victorious from the grave. And if he said that about himself, what did he say in addition to that? He also told us, as they sang so beautifully, that he's coming again. He also told us, as they have challenged us today, that we have a responsibility to experience his grace firsthand. Now, our text is in Luke chapter 24, and I want to look very simply at a thought right out of the text. Luke 24, we'll begin in verse 44, because it really matters what we believe about Jesus. It really matters whether or not we believe faithfully or we believe intellectually. If we believe as a matter of faith, or if we just believe as a matter of history. And I would encourage you this morning to take it from your head to your heart. And I want you to understand what Jesus is teaching us and what we need to practice today as Bible-believing and as born-again Christians this morning. Luke 24, verse 44 says that he was with them. He said, "The words which I speak unto you while I was yet with you, that all things must be fulfilled which were written in the law of Moses and in the prophets and in the Psalms concerning me." And by the way, everything written about Jesus in the law and in the prophets and in the Psalms concerning the Messiah was fulfilled in Christ Jesus. The odds are astronomical, yet it happened because Jesus was indeed the Messiah that the Old Testament presented. Jesus indeed fulfilled every prophecy in the law. He fulfilled every prophecy in the prophets, and he fulfilled every teaching in the Psalms about himself. And he opened their understanding, we're told in Luke 24, verse 45, that they might understand the scripture. And the great blessing of encountering Christ is that he opens your understanding what you need to do. And the more you understand Jesus, the more you understand the scripture, the more you understand scripture, the more you'll know Jesus. And it's a beautiful reminder for the growth pattern he anticipates for us as born-again believers. But notice verse 46, "And thus he said, it is written, and thus it behooved Christ to suffer." Do you understand that Christ suffered not for his own benefit, but for the good of all others? Do you understand that Christ suffered not because he deserved to suffer, but because you and I needed a suffering servant to die in our place? Thus it behooved Christ to suffer. The best thing he could do for you and me, the only thing that mattered, what really matters, is that every prophecy about Jesus was fulfilled in Jesus. And it behooved him, it was required of him to suffer. You know, so often we hear people today that they have better ideas than the scriptures. They have better ideas about how to get to heaven. They have their own ideas about how them and Jesus have a good thing going. But I want to tell you something today. Until you understand the scriptures, that it behooved Jesus, Christ must needs have suffered. He died because you had a sin problem, that you needed to find salvation. It was required of him to suffer. But notice the rest of verse 46. "And to rise from the dead the third day." Folks, I want to tell you something. We got good news to share with you this morning. It's not just that we're having a good time this afternoon. It's not just that we've had a good morning and we had coffee and donuts after the sunrise service. All that stuff's wonderful. But the best news we can share with you today is that you can find a risen Savior. It really matters because Jesus is alive. Every other outfit cherishes something of value that is gone from them. Have you ever studied religions? It's amazing. Some people cherish the fact that at some time, several hundred years ago, one of their religious leaders might have sat on a chair. Well, that chair is precious to them. Can I tell you something that's precious to me? Is what's not there. You see, the tomb is empty. The tomb is empty. My faith is not based on the fact that he might have sat in the chair at some time. My faith is real today because he's alive. And because he's alive, he can live in me and through me, and I can have life through him. It behooved him to suffer. He had to die for me because I had a sin problem. But he was risen from the dead the third day. Now that's what Easter's all about. And by the way, if you don't know this, we celebrate Easter every Sunday here at First Baptist Church. Every Sunday we celebrate the risen Savior. Now the calendar says that today is Easter, but in our heart, every Sunday is the Lord's day because he is alive, and he was made known of his miracle rising from the dead on that first early Sunday morning. But why? Why does it matter so much that he would be forced to suffer and to rise again? What's the point of it all? Verse 47, and that repentance and remission of sin should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. Wow. Jesus says, you remember I told you that I was going to fulfill all the prophecies of Moses and all the prophecies of the prophets and all the prophecies of the Psalms. Everything the Old Testament says about me is true. I fulfilled every single thing. I told you personally that I was going to suffer. And I suffered a horrible death. And I told you personally that I would rise the third day. And guess what? He is alive. Now, what's the responsibility for those of us who believe? That repentance and remission of sin should be preached in his name. See, I've got good news for you this morning. I've got the Easter story for you. It's not about Easter eggs. It's not about donuts and coffee after the sunrise service. It's not about standing on the front porch wishing we'd move inside. We moved inside this morning. It's not about all the trappings of the season and all the hams and mashed potatoes you're going to have this afternoon. It's not about all the pecan pies that are going to be thrown in ovens later, which, by the way, pecan pies are for rent. You know what it's all about? It's all about us understanding why. Why did Christ have to die? Why did Christ have to die and suffer? Why did he rise again the third day? So this morning, April 1st, 2018, in your presence, we have the privilege, the task, and the awesome responsibility of preaching remission of sin and repentance in the name of Jesus. This morning, I want you to understand that Easter is not just about the fun things. It's not just about an empty tomb. It's not about getting dressed up once a year. It's not about going to church once in a blue moon. It is about the responsibility of understanding a message. That because Jesus was required to die, and because he paid that terrible price on the cross because you and I had a sin problem, and he paid the ultimate sacrifice, and he completed all that God asked of him, and he died a death in our place, and by his own power and might rose himself from the dead so that we can find remission of sin. Now that's an old English word. We don't talk about remission very much, but it means the idea of being forgiven, being cleansed from it, it being removed from our account. You see, there's a truth that I need to share with you. That the Bible says all of us are sinners. All of us have a nature that causes us to sin. The Bible tells us that all of us have gone astray, that all of us have wandered away from the best that God had for us. And that disobedience is called sin. And in the Old Testament, they had to sacrifice a lamb every year, and they had to sacrifice goats every year, and they had to sacrifice turtle doves and things, because they needed a sacrifice for their sin. But at the Passover season, about 2,000 years ago, a man hung on a tree, and he died a horrible death on the cross, and all of your sin and mine were placed on that sacrifice that very day. And in his death, our sins have been forgiven, they've been remitted, they've been taken away. When we repent. Oh, Rusty, I'm sorry for my sin. That's not what repentance is. Oh, Rusty, I'm sorry I got caught. That's not what repentance is. Repentance is an earnest desire in your heart to know that you've done wrong against God and you desire to change. Repentance towards God means that you choose to say no to sin and yes to the Savior. Repentance is a change of life. It's a change of heart. And it's only possible in the name of Jesus. That's the Easter message. Oh, I'm grateful the tomb's empty. I'm grateful families get together. do around the Easter season. But the message is, repent and believe in the name of Jesus. This morning, if you're not 100% certain that there's ever been a time in your life where with repentance towards God, your sins have been forgiven, this morning I want you to meet Jesus. Not the intellectual Jesus you studied about, not the intellectual Jesus you've heard about, not the intellectual Jesus, not the head knowledge that gets you up once a year to come to Easter service or that gets you to come to church occasionally. I want you to know him through the repentance and remission of sin. That's only possible in the name of Jesus. That's the Easter story. Now I'm going to ask you to bow your heads with me if you would, because the only thing that really matters is whether or not you know the risen Savior. Just a moment, our choir is going to lead us to the time of invitation. Just a moment, I'm going to invite you to get up out of your seat and come. Our staff and other counselors will be available to share with you and encourage you this morning how you can know for sure that you know the Lord Jesus. You see, it's not just knowing the intellectual, the historical Jesus. It's about knowing that in your heart you've repented and that you've been forgiven because indeed you're a sinner. And I will challenge you this morning not to worry about who's sitting around you, not to worry about those near you. I'm asking you privately right now. I'm speaking to your heart. Do you know for certain this morning that you've repented toward God and experienced the remission of sin? Do you know for sure that you've been born again? Do you know for sure that the one who died on the cross and made a way for you to find forgiveness has cleansed you and forgiven you? And in his name alone, we find the freedom from sin, the cleansing from sin. See, this morning, I believe some of you are here because you got forced to come. Some of you got drug here this morning by your family and friends. But this morning, you've heard the message that's eternity changing for you. You see, it really matters what you do with Jesus. Not just playing church, it's knowing you've been born again. It's knowing that you've been forgiven. Through the repentance of sin and remission through the name of Jesus. Singular message we preach. The other choir begins to sing. I'm asking you to remain seated. I'm going to ask you to ask God to speak to your heart. And I'm going to ask you in this moment, when heads are bowed, eyes are closed, maybe you just need to slip out of your seat and come. The people near you will be glad to get out of your way. Maybe they'll come with you. But as they sing, you respond. God.